So my name's Josh Backfield. You can follow me on Twitter at jbackfield. And today we're going to talk about refactoring Java code from a normal imperative style into a functional style. We're going to take it in a couple of different steps, much as we did with my workshop, a couple of people here from my workshop from Tuesday. We're going to take it in a couple different steps. We're going to start out, we're going to do some function purity. We're going to go ahead and refactor those into their own classes, and then we're actually going to transform those and make them as part of data rather than just straight classes that you would pass around. From there, we're going to turn around and we're going to start doing some method references and get you guys thinking in terms of the Lambda syntax and what that means to you. So I'm going to go ahead and go over the code real quick. This is a very simple code base. If you guys want to, it's on GitHub right now. You can find my repository, jbackfield. The repository is the image generator. It's a pretty simple Spring application. So we got a couple of beans. We got an image generator bean. We got a factory. We have image draw. And the image draw is really about everything is going to happen. So in our main function, we obviously check bounds. We also are going to get the image generator from a bean context. And then we're going to go ahead and image generate the image at that point. The image will be generated with the string that's passed into it. So you end up with an image that looks similar to this. This is specific to my email address. The MD5 sum is down here at the bottom. So what we want to do is make sure that that never changes. And we're going to go ahead and begin refactoring in the image draw object. I'm going to walk through it real quick just so that everybody kind of understands what's going on here. We have the number of squares, so that's always going to be a square. So 10 would mean that it's a 10 by 10. 20 means it's a 20 by 20. The square size is the number of pixels that are going to be in each of our squares. The X and the Y are obviously where we're processing. And then you have a couple of different colors that you can pick from. The constructor is pretty straightforward. We're going to create a buffered image and then set our square size the number of squares. We have a seed so that we can seed our random. And then we have all of our draw functions. Now these are what actually generate the little images, the little squares, whether they're triangles or squares or whatever the case might be. That's where all of that takes place. So the next color method is to pick whatever the color is going to be at the end. That we're actually going to be painting right there, and then we have the draw method. The draw method is going to iterate over whatever the number of squares is, and it's going to go ahead and draw each one of the squares, draw inside of the square, based on whatever the random is that comes back. Everybody, pretty straightforward code base, right? So the first thing that we want to do is we want to look through, and we actually want to find places where we can extract different pieces of functionality from the image draw. So for example, we have the this.x. We have this.nextColor. These things are dependent on the image draw object. So what we want to do is we actually want to extract those out for each of these functions, and we actually want to make them as parameters being passed in. What we're going to do is we're going to copy and paste this into all the rest of the functions so that each one of the functions has the same parameters being passed into it. Oops. Once we get this done, we can obviously remove color because color is going to be actually passed into us. So we'll go through and we'll remove color for each one of these. Now obviously we're taking the buffered image, so the image is no longer going to be a this.image. We're also taking x and y, so those no longer actually need to be there. We also need to pass in square size, because square size is another argument that we have to take. This is what we call function purity, and essentially what that means is the function is never going to operate differently on the parameters that come in. So when you think about input determines output. That's exactly what we're talking about here. everything that's going to come into this function will directly determine what's going to come out of that function. In this case, buffered image is actually going to be a mutable object. So we're not going to be able to, we could pass it back. There's nothing wrong with passing it back. But the fact is buffered image is going to change itself regardless. So that's not a huge deal that we have void still as a return type, because the function still, regardless of what we pass in there, we can always tell what that function is going to do to all of its parameters, and in this case, what it's going to return. So now we can go ahead and refactor and get rid of the this objects. Don't know why my copy and paste, or my, it's because I'm looking at the wrong one, right? So I'm gonna go ahead and copy and paste, or I'm gonna search and replace. I meant to do only in the selection. And once we're done with this, all of these functions will be completely pure at that point. So no matter what we could call or where we're going to call it from, we'll always get the same exact functionality. So now these functions are pure, because everything that's coming into our function is now directly inside of the function. Meaning I no longer have any references to the this object. I no longer have any references to the image draw. This is extremely important because this is the first step in being able to refactor our code into a more functional style. We now have the ability to pull these things out. We're not going to do that just yet because we obviously have to update our calls to these, but that's going to be our next step, is to start trying to pull these things out. So what we're going to do is we're going to still push image to it. And square size. We can just copy and paste all of this right into these methods. So now, if I run this, I should get the exact same image, right? I haven't done anything differently. And in fact, my image is exactly the same as it originally was. So we've done no real different, we haven't changed the behavior of the functions. We haven't changed the behavior of the application itself. All we've done is we've extracted all of the parameters that we were dependent on image draw, into method arguments for all of our methods. Now the next one that we'll have to do is the color. So next color is going to take a random float. And we could do that just by extracting this. Notice how in each one of these cases, we're actually pushing up the stack the behavior that we want our functions to actually do. So in this case, we're pulling out the next color, actually calling the random next float, and we're actually pushing that up to the caller to say, you tell me the random number that you want us to use in order to figure out what to send back, what color to send back. So inside of here, we obviously have to do random next float. And yes, these method calls are getting really long, and I'm going to reformat them in just 1 second. So let me run it once again. Okay, and see, still no changes. So we're beginning to see some function purity starting to exist inside of these. And the first step that we can actually do is we can actually start to extract these functions into their own objects. And we're going to do that by first creating an interface. And that interface is going to be called a drawable. It's going to take the same parameters that we already have here. And the reason that we're going to do that is so that we can begin to create all of our functions, all of our objects that are going to be implementers, all of the functions that are going to be considered implementers that we're going to extract into their own objects are going to be actually part implementing this method. This is going to allow us to actually create instances of these objects and then iterate over those and look at those rather than trying to determine which one of these cases we're going to execute. And we're actually going to get rid of the case statement in a little bit. The case statement's pretty ugly. Does anybody know how nasty is this? This is pretty bad, right? You start getting into these case statements. Anybody ever have these at their job, at their work? I know I have. I've had tons of them. They're huge, and they're ugly to work with, and adding new ones is even harder. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to turn it into a list in this case, and that list will then be picked from by this random. But the size is going to be determined by the size of the list. And that allows us to just add more objects to the list in order to do our picking of what type we're going to draw. It won't change the behavior, like I've said. But what it does mean is that we don't have to come in here and add another case every time we want to add another form of drawing. So the first thing that we're going to do, now that we have our drawable, is we're going to go ahead and start creating these classes. And please bear with me while I create them. Notice though that all we're doing is we're creating the same object that we already really had here, and we're just extracting that function, the functionality inside of that function, into this object. That's all we're doing. Is there everybody familiar with the strategy pattern or anything like that, the state pattern? So it's the same concept, right? You're going to make a determination based on the specific object, even though all the objects have the same interface, right? So we're going to have a whole list of these things, and then we're going to make a decision on which square we're going to draw, which type of square we're going to draw by picking that from our list. If anybody has questions as I'm doing this, by the way, please feel free to ask them. Yes?
Is this similar? Essentially, you're just doing the extract method, the method object refactoring? It's a well-known refactoring.
Yes. So what we're doing is just we're extracting the method or the method itself into its own class, right? I thought this would be more interesting as I was doing it in my head, but apparently I was incorrect. I should have had this all done beforehand. Finally, this one. Okay. So now that we've gotten that, our next step is going to be taking these, and we're going to create the individual instances of them. So we're going to take, for example, this one. As I'm doing this, how many people have actually begun to adopt Java 8? It's an interesting poll. A couple people. Have you guys actually started working in Lambdas yet? You guys haven't? How many people are on Java 7? Java 6? Dare I ask, Java 5? Okay. I feel bad for you. I'm sorry. What's that?
Less than five, yes. There are actually some apps that are running on Java
1.0.
1.0.
Oh, 1.4. I pity you on that one. I apologize. It's not good. So in here, again, we're not changing the behavior. What we're doing was we're just going to have these guys call. And for whatever reason, I missed my lower left triangle. Okay. So now if we run this, and again, we shouldn't have any changes. The image should still be the same. And of course it is. So what we've done is we've just extracted these guys into their own objects. We've encapsulated the functionality into essentially a strategy pattern style, where each of these functions is encapsulated inside of its own object, which allows us to abstract that out. So now what we're going to do, though, is we're actually going to begin to make some of these static. And the reason that we're going to make some of these things static is because we're going to try and make ImageDraw itself a static singleton. Once we make it into a static singleton, it'll be a lot easier to see, and we can start to remove things like Spring out of it. We'll be able to get rid of some of the IOC. Some people still enjoy IOC. I'm one of them. I do like it. I think that it does have a good place, but I think that sometimes when you get into situations like this, there are definitely better ways to handle this. There are better ways to handle dependency injection. So for example, inside of our image generator, this resource, this image draw resource, actually would be a session scoped bean. Let's say that we embedded it into a web app. At that point, this bean becomes a session scoped bean, right? We're going to try and make that so that there is no dependency on the session scope. So you only have one instance. You don't even really have an instance of image draw because everything's static inside of it. So our next step, we're going to go ahead and make static. And that tells us that we have to actually make these static as well, which is fine. They're final. So there's no real reason to need to do that. So now next color is static. So I can actually change these to ImageDraw.NextColor. Now, our next step, as I said before, what we want to do is we want to try and get rid of that ugly case statement. And we can actually do this now because things that these objects were dependent on are no longer dependent. So we can go ahead, and what we're going to do is we're going to get rid of all of these guys. And I have to keep them in the exact same order. But I'm going to create a public final static list of drawables. And has anybody ever used arrays as list? Arrays as list, for those that don't know, will actually create an immutable list for you. What that does is that kind of starts to bring in your immutability into your application. So in this case, I have draw square is going to be first. Draw upper right triangles next. upper left triangle. Lower right and lower left. Okay, so now that we've gotten rid of those internal objects, we can actually take this and we can completely change this around. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually say ImageDraw.drawables.get. We're going to use our random and we're going to get the next int bound by the ImageDraw.drawables.size. With that, we can also immediately call draw, because we're guaranteed that the drawables, we can't go out of bounds on it. And we're also guaranteed that it's not going to be a null coming back. And we're guaranteed that it's not going to be a null because we've already set that. So I'm going to take this whole list right here. I'll paste it in here. How many people have done functional programming outside of Java? Maybe Scala or Erlang or Haskell or something like that. So you guys are familiar with this kind of, you're going to have a ton of arguments going to a function. And the best way to do it is to try and keep all of the arguments that you're passing to it kind of on the same line. So you'll have method arguments of, in here we have, what is that, 5? And it's huge, so we go ahead and break that up in order to make it a little bit easier for people to see. This also is an example of what we call method chaining. So if you look, what we do is we get the draw. So we have our list of drawables. We're going to get whichever drawable we want by looking at the random with the next int. We're going to bound it by image draw, drawables of size. And then we're going to draw whatever comes back. We're going to execute on draw whatever comes back. So this is an example of method chaining. We then return the image, and if all goes well, it should be the exact same image. Awesome. So now we're getting to a point where we can start looking for other things to extract out. Since draw is still non-static, it's still part of the image draw object, what we're going to do is we're actually going to start looking at ways to make draw more pure. So the first way that we're going to do this is we're going to get rid of the this on the int, or on the x. That allows us to take away a lot of these this statements. And then we can actually get rid of the x and y itself. What's that? No, I mean, did you have a question?
I thought you missed a couple, but I was mistaken.
Oh, okay. Okay, so at this point, everything that's inside of buffered image except for the random, the image itself and the number of squares is all inside this function. So what we're going to do now is we're going to actually get rid of the numbers of squares and we're going to get rid of the image and the random. So the way that we're going to do that is we're going to get rid of random and we're actually going to pass that in as a parameter. This allows us to do a lot more powerful tooling later. So for example, if I want to test and make sure that my draw method is going to come back with some specific image, think about unit testing, I can now test this every single time by passing in a random. I can mock the random, I can do whatever I want just by testing that one method at this point. We can also get rid of the set seed now, so we no longer need that. And so now here's where we're going to actually have to make a couple changes. So inside of here is now where we're going to define our new random. And as we define the new random in here, this is where we're actually going to set the seed. So we're going to do a random.setSeed. And that's string dot hash code. So at this point, I believe we should be able to run it. Yes. And we're still coming back with the same exact image every time. So now we're going to try to refactor out. We're going to get rid of the this.image, and we're actually going to make that as part of the draw method. As we do this, we're going to continue to decrease how much the draw method is dependent on image draw itself. So as we create the buffered image object, we can now use that and pass that to all of our functions rather than relying on the buffered image here as a member of image draw. The square size and the number of squares we're also going to pass in. This will give us the true function purity that we really want from our image draw class. So obviously we no longer need the constructor. I'm going to keep the constructor just for the time being until we actually get rid of the image draw factory. And this should give us the same image that we've been dealing with the whole time. Yep. So does everybody follow kind of what's going on here? What we're trying to do is we're actually trying to make image draw. All the methods inside of ImageDraw should be completely pure. They should no longer depend directly on an instance of ImageDraw, but rather should depend on either static finals or other static methods, which then can be you can pass in the arguments to them. At this point, we can actually turn this method into a static method. What is it complaining about? And inside of here, we can actually just do image draw. What's even more interesting is that we can now take all of this code that we were using from Spring, and we can just throw it into here. So now we have args of 0. We can get rid of all of our context. And now we're running in a completely pure Java without any Spring, doing almost the same thing that Spring would have given us. So now we have one main method, we have no Spring, and we have an image draw that's completely pure. So the next thing that we want to do now that we've made image draw pure is that we can actually take these functions, we can take these objects as functions as they are, and we can actually, let's say, put statics rather than having the draw methods just be the interface. So I'm actually going to make this no longer a drawable. Okay, it's complaining that it has no drawable interface, right? It doesn't know how to handle it. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to use anonymous inner function or inner classes. The anonymous inner classes, is everybody familiar with anonymous inner classes? Or at least has some? Okay, so for those that don't, essentially it's taking an interface, you can do a new on an interface, you can then specify any of the methods or all of the methods that have to be implemented by that interface. This gives you what's called an anonymous inner class. And inside of here, we're going to do a new draw square. If I can spell. And we're going to pass all the same things to it. Image, color, X, Y, and square size. I don't know why I didn't get a... that's what I wanted. Sorry about that. So, as I was saying before, I want to make these into static rather than instance methods. Not sure why that's complaining. Because that's not static, that's why. Okay, so as we continue through these, again, we're just gonna do the new drawable, and we're just gonna use this class. This, effectively, it's a static, it's a singleton, right? So we're gonna pass the image, the color, the X, the Y, and then the screen size to it. Same thing that we do with, that we've been doing with the ones right above it. And that's supposed to be square size, not screen size. Okay, as we said before, it's not going to change any of the actual functionality. So if we run this, we should get the same image once again, as we do. But now we're still in Java 7. So this is what Java 7 has pretty much for what we would consider lambdas. You have the ability to create an interface, and then you can create anonymous instances of that interface. So you're extracting the functionality that you want, the behavior that you want, and then you're allowing an interface to specify that, hey, this, any object that implements this guy is going to do that functionality for you. So how would this look in Java 8? I can show you once I convert it over to Java 8. So the first thing that's going to happen is my IDE is going to say, you're an idiot. Why are you doing all of these anonymous interclasses when you could just use Lambda syntax? And it is absolutely correct. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to convert this into a Lambda syntax. Okay. So I want to go over the syntax right before I actually go and do the rest of these. As you can see, we still have a list of arguments, right? The parameter list is up at the top in the parentheses. What I did was I brought the draw method from the drawable, and I just reused that parameter list. If you think about the way lambdas are designed and the way Java has anonymous interclasses, they're really kind of similar. There's nothing to be scared of with them. You can get in there and you can say, okay, I want to do something where I have a runnable. And a runnable is going to take no arguments, right? So it's the same concept. You can use the empty parentheses because that's your run method from the inner class that you're going to create. and then use the arrow syntax to say, this is the body of my method. Okay, so now we have a whole bunch of anonymous functions, a whole bunch of lambdas. And all of these are pretty much the same as the anonymous interclasses we had before. Yes?
How does a Java know the data type of unique caller and all? You just put it anonymous.
How does it know the data type for the image and the color and the X and the Y? It's determined by the interface drawables. It's an inference. So we know that the drawables interface has a buffered image and 4 ints, right? So we know that whatever the lambda is that we're going to pass to it has to have those same arguments. It has to have the same arguments. So that's how Java is able to infer that those are what the types are that are coming in. Cool. Are there any other questions so far? Yes.
So I'm trying to struggle a little bit with the static methods. And like for the past few years, we've kind of tried away from that, mostly for testability, right? So in this case, imagine that if any of those draw methods access a database to get data that it needed to actually do the drawing, and then that database is not available on your build system and you need an in-memory database instead. So how would you be able, like having everything as a static method, how would you be able to swap those things?
It's a great question. So the question is, how is it that you would be able to test something or be able to provide better testing with doing something like this versus having an encapsulation? And so the answer is, so image in this case, if you think about it, is kind of like our database. It's the thing that we're writing to. So notice that we're passing in the image object. So this allows us to make any kind of image object that we want as long as it conforms to the buffered image class type. So we could mock it, we could do whatever we wanted with it in order to do testing on it to make sure that certain coordinates are getting written to in this case, certain colors are being picked in certain instances, right? All of that is done by passing in all of the arguments. The function purity gives us the ability to have better testing on our methods because we know whatever goes in is going to determine the outcome of that function. Does that answer your question? Kind of, not really. No, you're fine.
Had code that would access the database, is that what you were getting at?
Right, yeah. But the answer is that everything would have to go in as a parameter.
Right, so in that case, you would want to send in, like if you had a customer DAO or something like that, you would want to send in an instance of the customer DAO to do the saves for you. At some point, that doesn't work, right? You're going to have a controller, and you're going to be at the root of the controller, and there's nowhere else you're going to be able to do it. But that would be the place that you would send it in to all of your other functions to say, use this DAO in order to perform your save function. Does that help clarify it?
Yes, I think when you have a big system, you cannot pass all your services and all your data everywhere, right? That's what we use the inversion of control for. We have 20 different DAO objects and we have 30 different services that are developed. But any entry point to a REST API call or anything like that, And if, like, you just have what's required for that method, at that point, like, are you saying that we have to start passing in all the other services?
No. So what I'm saying is that if you start thinking about some of these concepts in terms of static objects, right, you no longer have to auto-wire, right? The whole reason that you're doing auto-wires or at-resource annotations is because you want that singleton. And what I'm saying is the singletons are the things that you can actually break out into all of these static methods. You can pass those things in. And I'm going to show you in just a second with method references. So, for example, you could have a DAO, right? You could have a DAO that, or a service layer or some service component that needs a DAO. But maybe all it really needs is just the save function from the DAO. So now you could just say that it's a consumer of some type that you're going to send over, and then pass the DAO that you're looking at, the method on the DAO for your save. Does that make sense? Does that make a little more sense? It'll probably make more sense once I show you the...
Like, okay, for instance, like, suppose I have two implementations of my DAO object, right? One, that's cache. So one is a cache in front of the data store, and another one is a pure data store.
Okay.
So those are two different implementations of the same interface. If I were to build an application now using a Spring version control, I would just change my config file to say, like, okay, this is the, like, the cache version of, or the non-cache version of it, the one that gets wired into the object graph, and that's what all my services are gonna use, because that's what's gonna get injected. If I convert to the static thing and I want to change the cache version, do I then need to make a change everywhere that service gets called? Because now the type of the AO, since it's a static, it's gonna be hardwired whatever it's called. So in order to make the change to the cache version, you have to go and refactor it before it gets called, no?
Right. So the question is, if you have two actual implementations of a DAO that are implementing the same interface and you want to be able to switch between those on the fly, do you have to, with the static concept, right, the static singleton concept, do you really go in and have to change every single every single consumer of that static interface? And my answer is, in that case, stick with inversion of control. You don't necessarily need to make everything static, right? This is just one simple example, right? You could go so far as to say, you know, you only have a couple of methods that are non-static, and those are the entry points into your DAO with Spring, and then everything else that it's actually using inside of the DAO would be static references or static methods. Good. Yes?
If Drawl has more than one method, and you just match the argument list to whichever method you're calling it,
yeah. So is your question in here, if I were to have multiple draw methods that... So in here, remember, I'm manually calling .draw right now.
Right, but if Drawl has more than one method in the interface itself,
Drawl has more than one. Oh, I see what you're saying. That's a good question. I don't know how exactly Java would handle that. I haven't actually done that. What's that?
That's got a good functional interface.
That's right. It is a at functional interface. There's an attribute that you put there's an annotation that you add to the interface itself when you start doing this. I didn't do it. I should. But it does... Say that one more time.
You don't have to do it explicitly, but you cannot use non-functional interfaces for the DAO. They can be explicitly or implicitly, but it has to be only one.
There can only be one actual method on the interface, right? Yeah. So that answers your question. And yeah, you really want to use that at functional interface annotation. And I forgot it, but you really want to use that because it tells other people that this is really used for handling lambdas coming in. Are there any other questions so far? Okay. So what IntelliJ is actually complaining at me is that I actually have the same exact method arguments being passed in, as are being passed to the dot draw method. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to get rid of the lambda altogether, and I'm actually going to pass a reference of the dot draw method as my, essentially as my drawable. So what I'm telling the compiler at this point is that the method I want to send, is anybody familiar with C or C++ or any of those? Wow, that was a larger chunk than I thought was going to be. So if you think about it, this is the equivalent of sending a method pointer or a function pointer in and saying, hey, go ahead and execute this function in place of here. So in this case, right, we have a list of all of these different method references, or we will in just a second. And when we run this, we're going to pick out the method reference, just as we already picked out the lambda that we were going to execute, the drawable that we're going to execute. And as we pick that out, it actually is directly referencing the draw method on each one of these objects. The static draw method on each one of these objects. So now, this syntax has become completely condensed. We're saying that my first part of this array is as list. My first element is going to be the reference to the method draw on the object draw square. And it's a static method, so we use this syntax. We do the same thing for the right triangle, the upper right triangle, the upper left triangle, the lower left, and the lower right. We're telling it, here are all of the lambdas, here's all of the functions that we want to put in here. Here's all of the drawables that we want to put in here. So if we run this, we've still got the same output. So at this point, we can get rid of the square size and all that stuff. There's no reason to have this constructor. We can get rid of him. And I really want to refactor this next color. Yes? Great question. So draw is actually, what you're saying is I want that method draw to be replaced there. You remember the lambda that we had, and it had the method parameters already printed out. In this case, Java knows I still have to have those same parameters from the drawable, so I have to have an image, a color. I have to essentially have a buffered image and four ints. In this case, Java is saying, okay, as long as that method has the same signature, then you can use that. Then you can use that as a method reference. So if for example, if this draw method, for whatever reason, draw square had one extra parameter, I would get a compiler error because it can't figure out what exactly that is. It's going to say, no, I'm sorry, you added an extra parameter and that's not right. It doesn't conform to the drawable's interface.
So is that just because it's using Java 8 lambdas, it would be impossible in Java 7?
To do this syntax? Yeah. This syntax is strictly Java 8 right now. In Java 7, you could go back and you could do kind of what I was showing you before with the anonymous inner classes, and that would be how you'd be able to implement the same kind of functionality, right? Extracting the behavior that you want and then throwing that into an anonymous inner class somewhere else. No, it's not anymore. So what we're actually doing is it's all coming from here. So what we're doing is we're going to look at the drawables list, which is that list of method references. It's the list of drawable interfaces. We're going to get one of those at random, and then we're going to call the draw method on it. right? So, and then that's where we actually pass in the image object, our color, we pick the color at random, and then the X and Y and the square size.
So if you were to add, like, let's say a parameter to this draw method call right now, it should complain to you because it's smart enough to know, the compiler knows that what it's ultimately calling is the interface that's in the
system. You're talking about right here? Yeah, yeah. Right. So if I add another parameter onto here, that draw method, Java's complaining because it's expecting draw, it's expecting only 5 parameters because that's what the draw method says it takes. Right? If I go and I add another parameter, let's say to draw square, and let's say that he takes an int foo, I don't get a complaint here, but I will get a complaint here. Because now draw square draw, the method reference of draw is no longer conforming to the drawable interface. Does that answer your question? Okay.
If you had 2 draw methods, each with a different signature, would that in the interface, would that?
You can't have 2 in the interface. That's what this gentleman, actually, that's what that gentleman asked, and then this gentleman was kind enough to answer. So you can't have multiple methods on an interface that you're going to put in as a functional interface. And you do that really by the at functional annotation. The functional interface annotation that you see up there is going to tell Java that there should only be 1 method instance in there. So now that we've got this, and like I said, I want to refactor this guy, and so I'm going to do it just real quickly. So I'm going to bring the random check into here. And instead of setting these variables, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to immediately return from here. Again, this shouldn't make any changes, but what I'm doing here is I'm getting rid of extra variables. This is another really big, no arguments. Right, that's because that no longer exists. So what I've done here is I've actually made this function, and you'll find this in a lot of functional languages where you have implicit returns. So for example, and Java doesn't have statements or expressions, so the if statement doesn't actually evaluate into anything. If you go into a language like Scala or Erlang or Haskell, what you would do instead is you would just be able to say return, or you would have no return there. And you would be able to actually do the if statement, would it be able to return something? It would be able to return an object. The if statement itself becomes an actual object that you can kind of operate with. But in this case, I'm just going to go ahead and return these guys. So the last part that I want to do is I want to show the for each function. So in this instance, we really only can take one name, right? Everybody sees that, you know, we're already checking, is it one name or is it not? So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to change this to be, if this equals 0, then throw an error. Otherwise, we're going to iterate over a set of files and we're going to create all the files. Now, first way that we're going to do that is we're going to iterate over all the strings. Okay. And we're going to go ahead and run this again, make sure that my picture hasn't changed. And now we're going to go in here, though, and we're going to say we want to add in foo and bar. So saved. Yes. So now if we run this, we should have three files, not just one. If I look inside of here, I now have a bar at gmail.com and a foo at gmail.com, both of them PNG files. So what we're going to do now is we're actually going to take the arrays list and we're going to convert the array, the string array that we get in, we're going to turn that into a list. From there, we're going to do a for each on it, and we're actually going to execute this code block inside of the for each to show you that, to show you kind of how the Lambda syntax works outside of just creating your own. And I'm gonna show you guys, so the for each starts out as a consumer of string, right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do a new consumer of string, and inside of here, I'm just gonna throw this. So this is my new argument, and for each has come up a lot in functional programming. So what that for each does is it says, essentially, for every element inside of our list, we're going to execute this consumer. The consumer is literally an interface. It's a functional interface that says, I take one thing, and I operate on that one thing. I don't do anything else. So if I come in here and I remove, I'm going to remove both of those. I'm going to run this. This should actually regenerate those files for me, which it did nicely. But wait, new consumer is no different than all of the other interfaces that we've been dealing with, right? So we can now take this and we can get rid of all of this junk. And we can use that Lambda syntax. And we could say we take in a string and we're going to execute on that string. So if I run this one more time, I should get that. Yes?
So,
I'm sorry, say?
When you just reacted, you forgot the generic type description. I'm wondering if you use a method that's specific to a string, would you have to cast it?
So what's happening here, right, is that the type is inferred because the list is of a type string. And it expects a consumer of a type string because that's what that list is composed of. So that's how it knows that S is actually a string. Got it? Cool. Yes?
In Java 8, do arrays have a for each method?
Arrays do not. That's why I had to do the arrays.asList. And when you do that, that'll give you the list interface, which then you can either convert into a stream or you can do a for each on. Okay. Oh, yes.
Something that's bothering me is when you construct your list of drawables, you're specifying the draw method, as you said, a function pointer. But then when you're invoking that in an image generator, you're actually invoking the draw method, which yes. Seems like you're invoking the draw method on the draw method.
Yes. So the syntax is not the prettiest. I'll give anybody that. The syntax in Java 8 is not pretty, but you're right. So what you're doing is you're actually saying this method of draw on draw square is going to be the reference that I want to use. It then looks at that and says, okay, that is of a type drawable. So it's going to store it as a drawable type. Once you execute it, then you have to call the .draw method on it because all it sees is the interface. This is one of the real downfalls that I've found with Java 8's Lambda syntax, is that it still thinks of it in terms of an interface. You still have to treat it like an interface rather than just a straight method reference. In another language like Scala or something like that, you could just do a dot apply, or just run, you know, just do an open and close parenthesis right there, right after that, without the dot draw. But in Java, it does see it as an interface, and so it has to treat it as one. That's why it's the same thing that would happen if you were to create that new drawable. It's still being stored as the anonymous inner class of a type drawable, so at the end, you still have to do the draw method. It's the same concept. It doesn't abstract that out and say, okay, now you actually have a method, and you can invoke that. It says, well, it's of a type drawable.
So you call that for each on the list, so is that a method in the collection interface?
Yes. So for each actually comes into the list method or the list interface by Java 7 or Java 8. There's also a dot stream, so you can do a dot stream, which will then allow you to turn around and do filters or maps or reduces or any of that kind of stuff. It does exist, and then at the end of the stream, you have to do a dot collect, and you have to collect back into a list, which I find is kind of strange, but you get used to it after a while.
So for each method, we take a functional interface as input?
Right, and the functional interface, as we saw before, was of a type consumer, and the type can be anything that that's a superclass of string. Any other questions? Cool. Well, we got about 15 minutes. I'll let you guys go early if there are no other questions. Yes?
Just curious, do you have a Scala version of this program just sitting around you could show us?
I actually don't. I'll tell you what, though. I'll make you a deal. I'll write one tonight, and I'll get it published to my GitHub along with this code example. That is true. I will publish all of this stuff to the DevNexus 2015-session branch on my GitHub, and I will include the Scala part of it. Yes?
Yeah, so I'm kind of new to functional programming, so I attended a couple of these sessions. So I'm wondering, like, your take, I'm thinking, you know, moving from OO to functional. I remember when I was first exposed to object orientation, like, in, maybe even in school, you know, it, like, made this big point, like, you know, this is going to make more reliable software, because one of the hugest problems is the methods that operate on data are, like, divorced from the data, so you co-locate it. It has all the right rules. So this is kind of like undoing all that. So what's your take on kind of like, why are we making a total switch, or are we kind of trying to keep the best of both worlds? Or
I think what you end up with is you end up with a combination. I don't think that there's anything as a pure functional code. One of the examples that I gave during my workshop is you would never write a purely functional, like a purely immutable model. I mean, that's just going to be a nightmare, right? Everybody that comes in, oh, I need to change this model. Next thing you know, you get somebody who's not on board with immutable objects, and they're just like, this is terrible. I'm going to remove final from all these things. Or they're going to write a helper thing to go through and undo all the finals and set it all and then reset final. I've seen some of this stuff in action, and it just gets really nasty. I think that there's definitely a balance that you have to have. You know, if you have objects that are going between different functions, but maybe they're not being persisted, maybe they change, maybe they don't change that often. It's kind of up to you to kind of get a feel for when immutability makes sense. But with OOP, you really have a great concept. Conceptually, it's awesome, right? Oh, I have a car, and it can drive, and it has an interface, and I really don't care how the car drives.
Car itself. So stick that drive method right in there.
Right. And you can totally do that. And one of the things that I've seen done really well is to keep that, but instead have a static drive method that you then call. That keeps your function purity. It still lets you have a little bit of OO nicety, but it does give you the testability of the drive method. Does drive actually do what I think it does based on this car? So does that kind of, I know it's a very obscure answer, and I don't want to say OO is dead, because it's not. It's not going to go anywhere. We're still going
to
use it.
Like what you did, we could go in a time machine back to like not early 90s or whatever, and they would have said like, you want to do the exact opposite. You know, it's interesting.
It is interesting, and I mean that's what a lot of functional design is about. I think is, you know, using more functions rather than methods on objects. I think that there are definitely purposes for methods on objects. I think that there are plenty of use cases for IOC, Spring. I think that what we're going to end up is in a polyglot kind of way. The same concept, right? You're going to have all these different concepts thrown together that you're going to be able to pick and choose from. There's no one solution, right?
Right.
The thing,
like your take on it, but, so that's cool.
So do you feel like the functional programming and these kind of models are more applicable to frameworks and infrastructure libraries that you use?
Yeah,
a lot of them that you use are ISP, which you need object model application. You can have application, but it's designed something that's changeable.
Yes. And everybody gets hung up on immutability. And I'll tell you this, don't get hung up on immutability. That's the biggest thing. If you take nothing away from this specific session, take away, don't worry about immutability. It's not the end all thing. It's not going to solve all your problems. It'll probably create tons of headaches in the end anyway. Don't focus on that. Focus on the things that are really going to help you. Things like function purity are fantastic. They provide you a lot more ways to unit test your software. Things like being able to extract functions and extract behaviors and send those to other functions to operate. Most likely what I would do is I'd probably create a POJO, an immutable POJO, that encapsulated all of those properties and just send that to each one of them.
Right, exactly. That's what's
good. Yeah, that's another case where OO comes in, you know, kind of nicely. I mean, it's really nothing more than a struct at that point, right? But it's the same concept, though. You can totally encapsulate those things and then send those off and make them immutable. That's a case where making immutability would work. Because you don't want those things to change as they go in, right? You don't want those values to change.
Yeah, you want the immutability, but you also want the cleanliness of not having to deal with 15 arguments.
Yeah.
Right.
Big mess to start counting through and figure out the lines.
Yeah, and one of the really cool parts is when you start getting into like return types, especially from web services, and things are going to return a JSON object or something like that that has to be deserialized or serialized. One of the things that's really interesting is creating that object by actually passing in the return values of all the other functions that build that object. Not in a builder pattern per se, but actually you have all of the arguments or all of the fields on this object as part of your constructor, and then you just create the object at the end after you've returned all the other functions that build that object. I don't know, maybe that makes sense, maybe it doesn't. Kind of not. Okay, cool. Yes?
The thing that I've been getting out of it is the expressiveness, that when I look at the code, I don't have to follow a for loop and try to figure out what it's doing. It says sum, and I know what it's doing.
Yes, and that's one of the things. If you know, going back to this the for each loop, if you go into streams and you start using the filters and you start using the map functions and you start doing all these function chainings, right? So you're going to do, you know, if I had a little bit more time, we'd do like a filter and then we would filter out certain addresses and you could pass a closure to that, right? Or you could pass a lambda expression to that to say, here are the kind of addresses I don't want, right? I don't want anything that's not from Gmail or something like that. Then you could do a map, and you could do the map to actually create all of the image buffers. And then you would create another for each at the end to actually persist all of those image buffers to files. So yes, the method change, the changing, chaining is fantastic because now you no longer have these big Brobdingnagian functions, but you actually have a nice method chain that you can read and understand what it's trying to do step by step. Yes, sir.
I'm curious if something will work. If you were to refactor one of those objects, the name of the draw method is something like draw it, would that still work?
Yeah, so let me, I'll bring up draw square. I keep beating on him. So we're gonna create draw it, right? That's what you're saying. You wanna see if this works? Right, so it's gonna complain because draw it doesn't exist. But if I just say draw it, it's just a method reference. All it's saying is, as long as that method has the parameter types and the return type that it expects, it conforms to that drawable functional interface, it's good to go. It doesn't care what the name is, it doesn't care about anything like that.
But does that have to be a method?
It doesn't. The way that it wouldn't is if we were to create a function, and it's getting kind of late to do it, but if we were to create a function, you could reference the method on the instance variable. And the way that you do that is exactly what it sounds like. So if you had an instance of draw square, right, and then and you wanted to use the draw it, actually let me see if I can do this real quick.
So if you can use like
so if I do this, I can do that. So what I'm doing is I made draw it no longer a static method.
That's the case, why can't you let it be a implementation class in front of the same interface again?
Say that again.
Let it be a draw square in front of the draw interface again.
The draw, you mean why don't you just have it be the draw drawable interface? Right, so this is just an example. It's not meant to be a perfect implementation, right? I totally see what you're saying. And yeah, I mean, I would probably just throw that in as an object that extended drawable, because that makes it just makes it a lot simpler in this case. But where it doesn't make it a lot simpler is, let's say that you're going to do the for eaches, or you're going to do maps, or you're going to create your own function. Let's say you have a function that does do, my man left, but saves to a database, right? And then you can actually pass an instance of the customer DAO in the same syntax, right? So you would have customer DAO colon colon save, and you would pass that as a consumer of a customer type. Does that make sense? Yes. That's absolutely true. You could totally do that in one class and then actually reference. You can do that also, like if they were all in the same class and it was an instance class, you could do this colon colon if you wanted to. And you can pass the instance, the method instance, somewhere else. Yes?
So what are the best uses of using this functional programming? We started with the very nice, clean looking class and interfaces which we use every day. Here, I see one is like code is concise. Other than that, what else we are getting?
Like I said, I think you gain a lot of testability. You gain the ability as you start, and remember, we're not just talking about this specific syntax. Functional programming has all different concepts to it, right? You have the functions as objects, you have function purity, you have recursion over iteration, immutability, pattern matching. Pattern matching is not even something that Java, I don't even think it's going to support. I don't know if they've announced anything about it, but I haven't heard. But those are really important concepts in functional programming that we can take away and use. Function purity is great on testability. It allows us to be able to better control the things that are going in and know every single component or every possible failure or edge case that might happen. So for example, if I had a function and it took in a number and I got back the number 2, did it work or didn't it? I don't know. It depends on what that function did, right? Let's say it was called add, right? And I don't really know that, oh, when I pass 1 to it, it's actually adding some counter outside. So now I have an external state that's being referenced, right? Even though it's internal to the class, it's still an external state to that function. Now, if I force it to have to say, add takes in the counter and also the object and then returns a new counter with the numbers added, I can now tell every possible way that that can fail. I could get a null pointer exception. I could get, you know, a larger than max signed int or whatever the case might be. If you don't have that, there's a whole lot more things that can fail that you don't even know about. And that's what you get with function purity, is the ability to test all of those cases. Anything else? We've lost like everybody, half people. All right, well, if there's nothing else, my name is Josh Backfield. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much, guys. And have a great rest of the DevNexus.